excited to have this opportunity to present this work that I've been involved with and has been done by Yantic this year. And also in the second part, you know, after we published the first paper, we got interesting discussion. The couple of papers. So I will begin by saying something about the Valley Hall effect, and then try to explain why we think it's more natural to describe it in terms of Hall effect. So, begin with, as we know by now, the Valley Hall effect is one of many phenomena that have emerged in the last few decades, which all taken together amount to a small revolution in the way we understand the dynamics of electrons in block bands. And the revolution revolves largely around this recognition that the position, the familiar position operator R of quantum mechanics is not a proper well-defined operator in the Hilbert space of blocks, periodic block states. So one has to regularize that operator, and the regularization is done by adding to the usual derivative with respect to K, this connection term, which makes the operator well-defined invariant. Unfortunately, it also causes a problem that the various components of the R operator defined in this way do not commute with each other anymore. And in fact, there is a compact way to describe this lack of commutativity. This is saying that the cross product of R by itself, and this product is in fact is known as the Berry curvature, which represents minimal uncertainty of a wave packet that you can compose using only wave functions within the M span in this case. Okay. So now, once you have the form of the position operator, you can calculate the velocity operator by taking the commutator with the Hamiltonian. And the Hamiltonian, if the Hamiltonian has no electric field, then the only thing that you will get is the usual derivative of the energy with respect to K. Right? But if the Hamiltonian includes electric field, which is described by E dot R in the Hamiltonian, then you see that the non-commutativity of R other components of R causes the appearance of an anomalous velocity. Okay, and this anomalous velocity is perpendicular to the electric field and to the Berry curvature identified above. So you have this anomalous velocity omega cross E, and that's the basic driver of the effects we are going to discuss this talk. Okay, so here is, by the way, the analytic formula for this Berry curvature is well known to this calculated. Now, of course, you might wonder how come the astros and mermaid got away in the book without ever talking of Berry curvature, and apparently gave a very good description in time. Well, the answer is that the materials that they were dealing with were highly symmetric, high inversion symmetry, and also inversion symmetry. And when you have both the symmetry, you can immediately see that the Berry curvature has vanished because these two symmetries together imply that omega has to be equal to its opposite, but also equal to itself, and so it has to be zero. However, here we will be interested at least initially in systems that break inversion symmetry. Okay, and so in this system, of which a very good example is this so-called gap graphene system, which is like graphene except that you break inversion symmetry by making A and B sides. Okay. but it will also be a moderator of remote samples. Okay, so these are systems in which there are two inequivalent valleys. Okay, so there is no inversion free. As I said, this allows one valley to have one sign of baric curvature and the other one the opposite sign of baric curvature. So the total baric curvature is zero here. This is a non-topological material, okay? I'll come back to that point later. However, still we will have effects associated with the anomalous velocity in difference. And here we have the valley for effect. Okay, so we have we apply a field in this direction, and it generates opposite anomalous velocity in the two bands, because the two bands have opposite baric curvature. And so you see that the electrons in one valley, let's say, start traveling to the left, and the ones in the other valley travel to the right. And this leads to a separation and the possible accumulation of valley density at the edges of the system. However, we should also at this point pause and ask ourselves whether this valley Hall effect is really physical, right? Because the valley index, unlike, for example, the spin index, is not a very well-defined quantum number, you know, to say the least. So how do we say that an electron belongs to a valley or the other? Well, generally speaking, one way to proceed is to consider the Bredouin zone. Okay, the valleys, the inequivalent valleys are set typically K and K prime. And then you say that the point belongs to K or to K prime, depending on whether it is closer to K or to K prime. Okay, so in this leads to a nice, naturally very symmetric partitioning of momentum of the Bredouin zone into regions that belong to K and to K prime. Then, once you have that, then you say that, for example, your valley current will be computed by calculating the currents of the K regions minus the current of the K prime region. And when you do that, the new translations ultimately makes the result depend only on what happens really in the vicinity of K and K prime. So it sounds like a reasonable thing, but you see right away that there is a more basic problem. Mainly, even the sign of the valley current is completely arbitrary. Because, why should I define it as current of K minus current of K prime? Why not current of K prime minus current of K, right? So there is a total arbitrariness. Now, this arbitrariness will show up particularly when we try to combine together two systems, okay? Because then it will be, and I will give you an example in a moment, that then it's really crucial how we choose times, the relative times of the two systems become very important. So all these considerations led us in the work with Sciantica to suggest that we really may have a better, more natural and more physical description of this effect, the same effect in terms of orbital magnetic moment and in fact ultimately for effect. Okay. And the reason why this can be done is because these valleys carry electrons in these valleys carry orbital magnetic moments, which are defined in a very straightforward elementary way. That's in elementary physics, you define the orbital magnetic moment of a current simply as the product of R cross P. Okay, now here we are quantum mechanical, so we have to make sure it's Hermitian, P Hermitian. So you have R cross V minus V cross R. Okay, I have already introduced the R for you earlier, and the V is the commutator of R with H. So all you do is just some really simple algebra with this expression, and you immediately see, you recombine terms, and immediately see that there are two types of terms, right? Because V is a commutator, right? So it's HR minus RH. So there are terms in which H is the expression between the two R's, And there are terms in which H is the beginning or the end of the expression. Okay, so the terms with H in the middle with this, and the terms with the two R's in one side of the R, we can use this. Okay, so this is a very simple derivation. Okay, this expression has been, of course, noted in literature long ago, many years before. And it's an important part of the expression for the magnetization. Okay, but I want to emphasize that this has nothing to do with the thermodynamic expression for the magnetization. So in particular, we are considering here systems in which there is no magnetic field, therefore also no communications to intensity of states. So I hope this is clear. So our next step then, and I should say that this magnetic moment can be computed, and it turns out to have the same symmetry properties as the Berry curvature. So you see, well, it's almost. So you change the sign going from one valley to the other. That's the same. In one valley, you can get M of the one sign and the other dot of the sign. However, the magnetization is also the same for the conduction and the valley of sign. Okay, so there is that difference there. Okay, so you see that you can characterize valleys by the kind of the orbital moment that they carry. And that is a much more physical characterization. And now you can construct an orbital current, which is just, simplest thing you can do is construct it as the emission combination of orbital moment times velocity. Okay? And so you are led to, an expression that by now familiar, which is basically a combination of both the anomalous velocity and the orbital magnetic moment. Okay, so this, if this system is a metal, will also include a component, a longitudinal component of the current, but if the system is cut, it will have only the transverse component, whole orbital or current. Okay, so basically, the proposal is that this is the expression that should be calculated, and this is essentially what the valley Hall effect means. Okay, it's really an orbital Hall effect. Okay, so here. I am repeating. So this is the reinterpretation, okay, of the particle effect in which you see the electric drives current of orbital moment in opposite directions. The final formula expressed in terms of this orbital damage for the across. Okay, so here we go. And in fact, we calculated this for. The first thing we did, we calculated this for a very simple model. I was telling you about the A and B made an equivalent. It has half part of Berry curvature at A and A prime. You can do the calculation in a continuum model where everything is analytical. So this is the expression for Berry curvature, the magnetic moment, dispersion. So everything is analytical in each time. And you see, you have the product in this case, but not in general. It turns out that our orbital Berry curvature is just the product of the ordinary Berry curvature and the magnetic moment. Okay, so this is the thing that has to be carefully taken off. So the formula is very similar, except you have this higher power here. You okay to be fixed. So you're multiplying the thing that goes as a cube and the thing that goes as a square. So you do the calculation that is pretty straightforward, and here is the first of all well-known valley Hall conductivity as a function of Fermi level. So the Fermi level is the gap from minus one to one, and there you have a sigma quantized Hall conductivity, valley Hall conductivity, let's say, and then it freezes. Okay, so now if you repeat the calculation with our proposal, so you treat it as an orbital Hall effect instead of a valley Hall effect, then you find something that looks very, very similar with some qualitative differences. One is that the scale is going to be more rapidly because of the power instead of the power. And the other is also that you see now behind, when you are in the plateau, familiar in the gap, this height is no longer a universal quantity. Not here, it was one half. In fact, it's in this case can be related to Chern number, but here there is no such universality. So the value depends very strongly on the gap. The gap, and this makes perfect sense if you make it to think of for a second, because so you are transporting basically what you are doing. Instead of transporting charge, you are transporting orbital moment. So one of the E's here is replaced by a mu, an orbital magnetic moment, and the orbital magnetic moment is EH bar over 2m, right? It's Bohr magnetron. But the m, the mass, the effective mass of our system, which depends on its proportional delta, gap delta. So in essence, this depends, strong dependence on delta. Simply is telling you that the magnetic moment, so qualitative features. How am I doing in time?
You have 13 minutes.
13 minutes, okay. So I will simply mention that all this that has been done for the continuum model can also be done and has been done in fact with type binding model. Essentially, all the features are confirmed. Okay, so there are these hotspots of very curvature. But the interesting thing that I should probably emphasize better is that you see why would the very curvature has five sort of opposite signs at the two valley. Okay, so in order to get a finite result, you have to take a difference between one valley and the other, and that's where ambiguity arises. When you instead consider the orbital very curvature, the spikes in orbital very curvature have the same sign, the two values. So you are simply summing uniformly over the Brillouin zone, and you can do it in a completely mindless way. Just do an integral, you don't have to subtract contribution of one region from the other. So you know exactly what you're doing, and you know, you get the number which does not rely on the attribution of a certain region of momentum space with certain value. Okay, so that's, I think, the main advantage of this approach. Otherwise, we sort of see that the continuum model and the actual type binding model, they converge in the limit of small data, which again is completely expected. This is the technical point. Okay, so I would like now to show you the possibility. So this, at this point, we started talking with I would like to discuss some really more subtle issues that arise when you consider the behavior of an MOS2 monolayer versus the behavior of a bilayer. Okay? So why is there an interesting issue here? The first system, right, the monolayer shown here, okay, it breaks in terms of symmetry. So it, you know, it leads to you may call it valley Hall effect or orbital Hall effect. Okay, so I already expressed my opinion that orbital Hall effect is more correct physically. But anyway, you know, everything works as you would expect. Okay? But now, when you put two of these in a particular stacking, which is called 2H stacking, then you restore inversion symmetry. Okay, so you can convince yourself that that point there is a point of symmetry for the structure. And now, okay, so what happens to these calculations here were done by the group of Tabiana here. And you see they calculated both the spin-off effect and the orbital. Now, the spin-off effect is this red line, it's practically zero, right? So it seems that you know, there's very little spin-off effect going on. But the orbital Hall effect, particularly when the level is in the gap here, is essentially one quantum, okay, or one half. Okay? or there be anyways, one tide in the plateau. When you go to this system here, which has an inversion symmetry, lo and behold, you get exactly twice value that you got there. So it is as if the contributions from the two layers added up simply. Okay. So the orbital hole effect, you know, doesn't rely on inversion symmetry that we have heard amply on break. So does not rely on breaking on inversion symmetry. So even though this system is centrosymmetric, it does have an orbital hole effect calculated. However, according to the conventional wisdom, if you want to describe this in terms of Valle Hole effect, then you run into trouble because the system is centrosymmetric. So each band, according to the arguments I gave you in the beginning, being time reversal invariant and you know, inversion symmetry invariant, omega should be zero, and then you should not have any Valle Hole effect. So here there is a clear distinction, right? It matters a lot whether it is Valle or effect. So this result suggests that the now we show you a cartoon, which may or may not clarify the picture. Okay. So I will start by cheating a little bit and just neglecting completely the coupling between the two layers. So I have a top layer. I have a top layer which has the two valleys, and this is the same diagram that I plotted earlier. So each valley has its own omega and its own m. Okay? So this one would give you, for example, a valley for effect, because you know you have a positive omega here minus a negative. So you subtract the current value, you get a valley for effect. Okay? So the question is, what happens? The bottom layer. Okay. So the key question you see here is if we define the value current as the difference of k prime minus k, then the crucial question is how do we establish a correspondence between the k and k prime in one layer with the k and k prime in the other layer. Okay? So if you do what I'm doing here, if you say that the k value here has the same structure as the k prime valley in the top layer, then in under this assumption, you see that the valley current here would be on one side as a positive, and the valley current here is defined as k prime minus k, you have the opposite sign. So you put them together, you get zero, right? The zero valley would effect. However, you might also argue that this is not the right way to do things, okay? And you could decide to design it to associate the value in a different way, and then you would conclude that they somehow. Okay, so there is an ambiguity here. So now the use of the orbital description, you know, orbital moment description resolves this ambiguity, at least for the first 5 minutes. Because you see that omega times m, the product of these two things, has the same sign in both valleys. Almost
five mornings.
Yeah, I think it's around that. At the same, so you add things, and then also the same thing happens in the bottom layer. So you naturally get twice the contribution. There is a weakness in this cartoon, a big one. Maybe I completely. So basically, I'm hiding the fact that according to the general principles, because this bilayer is centrosymmetric, each band should have exactly zero omega and zero m at each k. Okay, because of the. Simultaneous presence of time reversal and inversion symmetry. So how is it possible that in the end we get a finite orbital hole effect? Okay, here is where the reason why that can happen is because actually that the very orbital very curvature is not is a matrix product of m times omega. Okay, it's not the product of the in-band M times the in-band omega, but there are also off-diagonal elements, okay? It has a matrix structure. And this is what was done in the recent work, okay? So the proper calculation which you allow a coupling between the, let me skip this and also this. Okay, so in this calculation, this is also written the PLB with Tatiana. Well, you know, you see the basis of orbital in layer one in layer two, so you reduce everything to very simple, you know, formal matrices. But now, you know, there is interlayer hopping, so you really have the dance that leave on both layers simultaneously. And when you bring that, you realize that the orbital current operator that is off diagonal. Yes. Diagonal terms, and which are crucial in giving you a finite result. So the finite result, which is plotted here, depends quite a bit on whether you use an interatomic picture of the orbital moment. This is the thing that should be probably, or if you use instead the formula that I have proposed previously in the slides. Okay, so the Berry curvature formula. Okay, so essentially these two calculations differ by a factor of M0 of Q, where Q, M0 of Q is the magnetic moment of the trajectory vector Q. But qualitatively, the two results are very similar. There is no doubt that layers contribute additively to the four effect. Okay, now, really, I have a lot of things still to say, okay, but I have to say, first of all, that I I would have hoped that this would be, you know, a very clear-cut experimental verification. This relatively old experiment of 2016 on the MOS2 bilayer, okay, in which they measure through pair rotation, right? You see that the two ends of the bar. The current flows in this direction. So there are accumulations of orbital moments of opposite signs to two edges. Okay, so that's very good and encouraging. Now, the only problem with this is that you see that they also have a perpendicular electric field, which creates a bias, a potential difference between these two layers. And when that electric field is you know, fine-tuned in such a way that the system becomes, according to them, central symmetric, then seems that the accumulation vanishes, okay? Which is obviously in conflict with you know, what we expect, and say is completely the opposite of what we expect, because it could be impacted the accumulation should add up. So this remains, I want to mention briefly that, you know, I think it's fair to say it's an open question that can be understood better, you know. Now, the other thing that I wanted to say is that one has to be extremely careful. Yeah, 2 minutes, but I have to make this point because it's really important, I think. So in calculating these accumulations, you have to be really extremely careful. Okay? But, you know, you are dealing not only with non-conserved quantities, which was already the case with the current, but in this case, it's more tricky even than that, because the magnetic moment depends on K, unlike the spin, which is K independent. So the standard way to calculate the accumulations at the end, it is a specific metallic system, okay? It's true. Use these drift usual equations, which have basically two ingredients. Okay, the first is the continuity equation for the, let's say, the valley density, but this could also be the opposite magnetic moment density. Okay, the eventual density is minus divergence of the current, but then it's essential if you want to fix the profile of the accumulation to have some estimate of the relaxation time here. In the case of this problem, yes, the most important relaxation time is the intervalley scattering, which relaxes, you know, the equivalent to spin slip. So you take this and then you say that the valley current contains, you know, in general, the dissipative diffusion piece, which is going to be a gradient of the density, and then contains this whole valley hole or orbital hole term. So you combine those two equations, you arrive with an equation that contains the whole current source term. You solve it and you end up with that profile that I showed you. Okay, so fine, so far so good. It seems a relatively straightforward running program.
Could you summarize?
Yeah, so the summary is that is not true, because there is an additional term in the continuity equation that comes from the fact that when you have an electric field, there is this term here which comes from the K dependence of the divergence of the charge, of the magnetic charge. And this can change things dramatically. And we think that may be a reason why no impact will be zero, exactly zero relation instead of an insulator. Which might explain the result of that experiment, but I'm not sure. Okay. I also have if you want to have time, I can show you how I think that the quantum Hall effect can be understood as an orbital Hall effect. So anyway, and here is the summary I leave it for you to take a look at, because I'm out of time. Okay. So thank you. Sorry for going over time.